We are now going to look at some synthesis coding guidelines, or in other words, how to write Verilog in such a way that it is likely to get synthesized in pretty much the way that you want. Two things to look at over here. One is the overall process of synthesis, what does it involve? And then we'll be looking at some guidelines given by Xilinx. So what exactly is synthesis? Synthesis essentially is the process by which the Verilog code that you have written gets converted into a netlist or a set of gates. Now, if you had a structural piece of logic, let's say an AND gate, it would be very easy. All that you need to do is essentially try and replicate an AND gate in the hardware. You know, in other words, that since the designer has written that an AND gate is required over here, the hardware should therefore try and realize an AND gate. Similar things hold for the assignments, continuous assignments or data flow. Let's say you have an equation, y is equal to a ampersand b, assign y is equal to a ampersand b. Once again, you know, this is the equation to be implemented. This is its truth table. You can optimize and then map once again onto hardware. The main sort of optimizations that would need to be done over here relate to the fact that inside the FPGA, you do not really have AND gates or OR gates. What you do have is lookup tables. And therefore, you need to figure out how to take the equations that you want and optimize them for that implementation. So something, for example, like a full adder circuit, where I might normally write the code as S is equal to A XOR B XOR C, would be much more easily implemented by just having a simple 4-input lookup table or a 3-input lookup table, correspondingly with the values that it needs to have for a full adder. You do not actually need to worry about how an XOR gate is implemented. Now, in other words, structural and assignment are fairly easy to understand in terms of how they would get converted to a netlist. The tough part, or the interesting part, where Verilog actually becomes useful is in converting behavioral patterns into hardware. And the way that this is done is primarily by means of some kind of pattern matching. There are templates of certain kinds of code that have been specified by the compiler, and the compiler essentially understands that if the code is written according to those templates, it corresponds to a certain type of hardware. An important aspect, of course, while defining these templates is that it needs to maintain fidelity to the simulation semantics. In other words, the behavior that is specified in the simulation reference manual of Verilog is what has to come through as a result of the hardware that is generated. Now, of course, Verilog has a whole bunch of non-synthesizable constructs. In particular, things like file input output, fread, dump vars, various kinds of reading memory files and so on are not directly synthesizable. Having said that, there are some exceptions. In particular, the read mem commands can be used in order to initialize the values of memory, at least in Xilinx memory blocks. Similarly, there are functions and tasks. Functions and tasks are used primarily in test benches in order to automate certain steps of the testing process. However, you could also have a function or a task that is synthesizable. You might find that rather than writing an always block with all the logic completely written out inside it, it makes sense to write out a function and call that function, provided that the code that you have written is in such a way that the function essentially just evaluates what essentially corresponds to a combinational piece of logic. It can, after all, be synthesized. And the other thing that Verilog typically has trouble with is arbitrary logic flows. Flags can be used in various kinds of Verilog code. However, they have to be used with care. In particular, if you try to set a flag and depending on that value of that flag, then change the logic that you have all inside the same always block, there's a good chance that you will run into trouble. Another kind of logic flow that typically will give trouble for Verilog is recursion. It's not very straightforward to implement something like that. There are techniques that can be used to flatten recursion and convert it into loops, but the Verilog compilers in general do not even attempt to do such things. Xilinx, which is the vendor of the FPGAs that we will be using for our assignments and is also the biggest vendor of FPGAs worldwide, provides their own compiler, their synthesis compiler. There are other compilers. So for example, Synopsys and Cadence both have their own compilers that usually are used for targeting custom ICs, but can also target FPGAs. There are other vendors as well who specialize in compilers purely for FPGA architectures. But given that the Xilinx compiler is fairly good, we are not going to be exploring any of those. What I will be showing next is a set of patterns that are recommended by Xilinx for use in coding in such a way that they essentially say that if you write your code according to these patterns, this is what will get synthesized. In order to go through those patterns, the simplest way is actually to run the Vivado software. Now, you will not be able to run this GUI version of the Vivado software on the Jupyter terminal that is provided for the class. But on the other hand, you can install the webpack, the free version of the Vivado software on your own machines and go through this. Most of the language templates themselves are fairly straightforward and will be provided to you separately. So this is not absolutely necessary that you install Vivado just for looking at the language templates. However, the software does have a lot of other uses to it. And especially if you plan to use FPGAs a lot more, it's probably a good idea to install it. Once you have opened Vivado and you create a project, it doesn't matter what. In this case, I have essentially opened a project corresponding to an adder, but you could just create any project at all that you want. It doesn't really matter what you have got inside it. The important thing is on the left-hand side pane under Project Manager, you can see something called Language Templates. If you click on the language templates, it shows a whole bunch of options. The one that is of particular interest to us comes under the heading of Verilog, and in particular, the synthesis constructs. If we open this, we find that there are, you know, for example, how to write an always block, and all that it says is always at negage clock, and the clock itself has been put within the angle brackets. If reset, once again within angle brackets. And the reason for all of these angle brackets is because those are parameters that you need to replace with actual signal names of your own. The good thing about the way this code is written is that it guarantees that if you just copy paste this and do not replace the angle brackets with something sensible, it will cause an error. So at least you can use this template and then replace the signals as you need with appropriate signal names of your own. Now, what's particularly interesting to us comes under this heading called coding examples. And if you look here, you will see that it says how to design accumulators, arithmetic, basic gates. Let's take a look at arithmetic, for example. And what you can see is it also tells you how you can implement different kinds of adders. So a combinational signed adder, for example, could be written this way. Look at the way the code is written. It uses a parameter. You could also use a define. But a parameter in some sense is nicer because it can be modified when you instantiate the module. It allows you to define a parameter which corresponds to the adder bit width. It then declares three wires, two inputs and an output, all based on that bit width. And finally, it just uses a continuous assignment statement to actually evaluate. Keep in mind that as far as FPGAs is concerned, this is the most efficient way by which you can actually implement addition. Any other thing where you try to actually explicitly implement carry look ahead logic or logarithmic tree adders is probably going to end up being slower because the FPGA logic by itself is tuned towards implementing very efficient ripple carry arithmetic. What if we want to implement something else? Let's say a subtractor. A simple subtractor would just use minus. What about a multiplier? An 18 cross 18 multiplier. Why the specific number 18 cross 18? This is because that's the hardware that's actually available inside a system. If you want to implement any multiplier up to 18 bits into 18 bits, this is the best way that you can write the code. Just use an always at passage clock product less than equal to A into B. And the reason why this is written is that this is code that can very easily get inferred by the compiler to correspond to one of the DSP slices that is present inside the hardware. On the other hand, if you wanted to have an arbitrary input bit width, you can do that. And you can then write the code in exactly the same way, A star B. What will usually happen over here is that the compiler will then figure out, let's say that you're trying to do 32 cross 32 multiplication, it will actually try to break it up into multiple 18 cross 18 blocks in such a way that the 32 cross 32 is efficiently implemented as a combination of multiple other such blocks. What are the other important kinds of logic that you are likely to come across, especially in implementing a processor? One of them is something called a decoder. This is, for example, the stuff that you would have when implementing, let's say, something like a register file. How you can implement a decoder is like this. And this is a clocked decoder, right? Because it has an always set postage clock. But if you look at it, the decoder functionality itself just comes inside this case statement. And this cleverly just uses the case statement to say for each of the different options or different input possibilities, it specifies what the output should be. Now this default, of course, should never happen because you have specified all the possible outputs over here, 00, 01, 10, and 11. So why should I specify something for the default? That's sort of for the optimization, or in other cases, when you have some kind of a case statement where it is actually not specified. From the point of view of simulation, it also takes care of the thing that even if the inputs to the decoder are unknown, X or Z for whatever reason, the output will still be zero in this case. Whether that is desirable or not is left to the designer. You need to know whether that's the way you want your code to behave. Now, when you actually write a register file, you probably don't need to explicitly write a decoder like this, but you may probably find that some kind of a case statement or some other way of writing the code may be useful in actually implementing logic of this sort. This would definitely be useful, for example, in an ALU, where, for example, you have multiple different blocks that and the output, the input needs to be sent to one of them, or the output needs to be taken out from one of them. Which basically brings us to the other important block that you are interested in, which is the multiplexer. And the way that you can implement multiplexer logic, let's say a 4-to-1 multiplexer, is once again using a case statement. Here we have the two input, 2-bit select, and the four inputs, input 1, input 2, input 3, and input 4. And based on the case statement for the select signal, it just assigns the output. Note that this is purely combinational, and you can note in particular over here that it uses blocking assignments. Keep in mind that we already said use blocking assignments for combinational logic and the non-blocking assignments only to implement the update of a flip-flop, the sequential updates. Now, all of these are pretty much all that you would need in order to implement anything up to an ALU. But after that, and in later parts of the design, things will actually get tricky. And one particular thing that you need to understand very clearly is how to implement RAM. Memory. Memory can be implemented by coding it directly in Verilog. In particular, what you could have is you could implement something like this. This code now looks really complicated. It has many parameters. It has the depth of the RAM, the performance parameters, an initialization file which can directly be used in order to load it with initial values. And more importantly, if you go down and look at this, you'll actually see that the main functionality essentially corresponds to something like this. The main functional part of the code is actually very easy to understand. All that it's saying is, if you're trying to read, then look at the edge passage of the clock. And if this particular memory is enabled, just take the value from that array corresponding to address A and assign it to the output RAM data. So the entire read functionality is encapsulated in this always block. What about the write functionality? That is done using something slightly more complicated. It uses something called a generate and end generate. Do you really need to write code of this sort? Not absolutely necessary. You will probably find that you can write somewhat simpler code that can achieve the same purpose. But knowing how to use generate codes, statements, for example, in Verilog can be useful when you are trying to design larger systems. For the kind of logic that we are talking about, it's probably not essential. The other things that you are likely to come across, one of them is shift registers. It has some implementations of shift registers, simple shift registers, and so on. State machines. And there are two types of finite state machines, the Mealy machine and the Moore machine. And once again, over here, there are many different parameters. Right? The fast state machine encoding essentially has something which does not really specify what to do in the case of the default, that is to say, none of the known states. What if you start in an unknown state? The safe encoding, on the other hand, makes sure that if you are in an unknown state, or if you are coming in on reset, then it will always go back to state one. Which one do you need, and how do you actually go about implementing the state machine? That depends on the application that you are trying to, the problem that you are trying to solve. One last thing that could potentially be useful is the use of tri-state buffers. However, this is something that, as far as possible, try and avoid it unless you know exactly what you are doing. It involves assigning the value Z directly to an output register. Now, from the simulation point of view, that's easy to understand. From synthesis, it's a bit harder to know exactly what this is going to result in. The reason being that this actually requires a corresponding piece of hardware that can actually be tri-stated by applying a signal. Only very specific parts of the FPGA have this functionality. So you need to be sure that the part that you're applying it to is something that is capable of doing this. For example, the IO buffers have such a capability, but general flip-flops inside the FPGA probably do not. Coming back to the core concept over here, how do you guarantee that your design is going to be synthesizable? You should never, in general, be writing your code, synthesizing it, and then trying to explain what it does. Instead, you should have a picture in mind saying, this is my block, this is what the block does, these are the inputs, these are the outputs, and this is how it behaves. And then write the code that realizes that functionality. That's the only reasonable and safe way that you can write Verilog code that will actually do what you want it to do.